And look, people are heading for the hills, looking to get away on a little vacay. Well, the big crowds back at airports right across the nation as millions of holiday makers jet off ahead of the school holidays and airlines prepare for their busiest period in 2 years. Check it out. Oof. We have team coverage. There's Christine Ahern on the front line of the war zone. Chris, good morning to you. What's been the reaction?
Well, Carl, everyone's actually been pretty happy because you know why? They're heading somewhere sunny like the Gold Coast. Now, I'll just show you the queues because there is good news. It has significantly decreased since this morning. So if you remember when I was here 5:30 this morning, these queues snaked right back to the international terminal here in Virgin. But I'm told by the Melbourne Airport that we're past the peak and it'll remain about this busy for the rest of the day. Here's what some passengers had to tell me earlier.
We booked 18 months ago and didn't anticipate it coincided with school holidays, and we're looking forward to going in the business lounge and sitting back having breakfast, but it looks like that's not going to happen now.
Of course, there's a lot of problems at the other end of the journey when you're waiting to collect your bags, some for hours. And this memo from Swissport, which is the contractor to Qantas, shows that they're actually paying baggage handlers an extra $50 a day just to turn up to work to try and fix that shortfall. Carl?
Chris, I'm going to rant just briefly. I don't know why in this country we don't have a separate check-in and security line for families with kids. Come on.
Come on.
Come on. Let's move for change. Well, Jess Millwood, can you make that
These people here might
happen?
Agree with you.
Yeah. Sorry, cut out then. Jess Millwood at Brisbane Airport. Hands up if you want to see that change in Australia. There we go. Let's just get it done.
Amen. Amen. I think we should also just be able to hire a flight attendant to travel with your children so you don't have to. That would be a better option. Because I'm still traumatised over a recent flight, but we won't go into that. Sullivan's passport's been cut up. Anyway, I digress. Lots of kids here. Lots of kids here, so I'm feeling really sympathetic. But Brisbane Airport is buzzing once again. It's really nice to see. Look, the delays here haven't been too bad. The wait time to go through security has been about 20 minutes. A lot of people heading off on holidays to other parts of Queensland. They have heeded the warnings and they have arrived early. This is the line for check-in. Speaking to Brisbane Airport, they have put extra staff on to check in so that we avoid the scenes that we did see at Easter time. But I just want to give you an update. There is a fog that has blanketed over Brisbane City. I've asked the airport. There are no delays related to that fog. So all of those people from Sydney, from Melbourne, coming up to warm, sunny Queensland, no delays so far.
Just Carl? Quickly tell us what your experience was like on the plane with the kids.
That was terrific. I want to apologise to everyone on FJ920 a few weeks ago coming in from Fiji.
It's
the
horrendous.
Flight attendants were traumatised. I was traumatised. Coffee went flying. Anyway, sorry.
It's horrendous.
We can talk about that another time.
Good on you, Jess. Right on the front line there too. And Chris, appreciate it.
I can see the trauma in her eyes. Well, one of Australia's top doctors has declared influenza should be treated like COVID. Queensland's chief health officer has made the warning as flu cases soar right across the country and hospitals are struggling to cope. Australians are being urged to take advantage of the free flu shots before they come to an end across much of the country next week. And we're going to have more on this with two medical experts joining us on the show very shortly to talk about kids and respiratory and flu cases. Well, reassurance for parents struggling with the cost of living this morning with emergency childcare support set to be extended. Let's go live to Lara Vella, who's in Sydney. Lara, how long will this be available for?
Ali, I've got good news for all those working parents this morning. This program, it's going to be extended by another year until June 2023. Essentially, Ali, this program was brought in during the height of the pandemic to help working parents save some money, but also give them peace of mind to know that when their child contracts COVID-19 and they've got to pull out their little one from going to daycare or childcare for 7 days, that not only will the child not lose its place, the gap fees will now be waived, and also the childcare centre will also receive the government subsidy.
Thanks for that, Lara.
The Victoria government is in crisis mode this morning with Premier Daniel Andrews set to be forced into a major cabinet reshuffle 5 months out from the state election. Four senior ministers are expected to announce today that they are stepping down from their roles. They include Deputy Premier James Molino, Police Minister Lisa Neville, Martin Pakula and Health Minister Martin Foley. His resignation will mean the state will have its fourth health minister in as many years.
Well, 2 days ago, something personal. My daughter Harper had what she's had so many times this year, and not alone, a sniffle and a small cough. Within about 6 hours, she had a temperature. It wasn't too bad, but nonetheless was there. We gave her Nurofen and Panadol, like advised, and put her down for a sleep. When she woke up, she was breathing really quickly, wheezing, and her heart rate and temperature were through the roof. So we took her to our GP, who is brilliant. But within a couple of minutes, her condition deteriorated. Her temp was more than 40, and her heartbeat was climbing over 200 beats per minute. We were really worried. Our GP did incredible work, stabilised her with a nebuliser and called an ambulance. From the ambulance officers were incredible. At North Shore Hospital, more doctors worked on her and she was admitted after several hours at emergency. They did a brilliant job. The hospital staff, unbelievable. The reason why I'm sharing this is because I know we aren't the only ones going through it. And when we put a call out on social media, there were literally thousands of parents in similar situations. We were lucky, and we are lucky, it wasn't more serious. And we were lucky we had good people around her. But this is a shared experience this morning. That's why we're doing it, Ali.
Yeah, and when it happens, it is really, really scary. That's why we've brought in the experts who can break down exactly what's going on. And we're going to go first to Royal Children's Paediatrician, Associate Professor Margie Danchin, who is in Melbourne. Professor, you just heard there what Carl and his wife Jazz went through with little Harper. What are you seeing in hospital wards right now?
Good morning, Carl and Ali. Yes, Carl, that is unfortunately a familiar story at the moment. After the last 2 years being so tough with COVID for parents, we're now seeing just a huge increase in viral respiratory infections for children. Since March, April, we've seen a big increase in flu A for kids, with lots of presentations to the emergency department and about 20% of children needing admission to hospital. And also in the last sort of month or so, we're also seeing an increase in presentations and admissions for RSV, which, Carl, is what I suspect your daughter probably had. And that's sort of the most common respiratory and infection in children, and it causes bronchiolitis, pneumonia, and even triggers asthma. So, you know, parents are really dealing with this sort of massive influx of respiratory infections at the moment.
The thing is, and what Ali's saying is 100% right, you just panic. And when doctors start moving fast, you start getting more worried. And I think that the hardest thing for us was knowing, I mean, we felt guilty about it. We should have probably taken her directly to hospital. We took her to the GP instead. How do you make that decision? What are the things you can tell a parent this morning that helps them make that decision?
Yeah, and this is very good to discuss up front because, as we know, our emergency departments at the moment are really overwhelmed, and we don't want parents going to the emergency department waiting 6-8 hours if they can go to their GP. So, as you correctly said, if a child has increased work of breathing or rapid breathing, what we call breathing difficulty, or any blueness around the lips, or any signs of dehydration, so if the child is not drinking, if they're listless, pale, those are the things that should encourage a parent to take their child to the emergency department rather than straight to the GP.
The breathing thing is...
If the child has a fever... I was just going to say, if the child has fever, cough, runny nose, those sorts of more mild respiratory symptoms, then we would encourage them to access community care first.
Can you explain, because this was the first time I'd seen it, the difficulties with the breathing and something that the paediatric ward looked at and something that the ambulance officers looked at and also, firstly, our GP, who did an incredible job. The breathing rate is different and they're using different muscles and that's an indicator of fatigue. Can you explain how we can look out for signs like that?
Yeah, so, you know, we teach parents to look. There's an indrawing at the bottom of the neck, or called, you know, sort of tracheal tug, which is a little sort of movement here. Or work of breathing is seen sort of with under the ribs, where you get sort of what we call intercostal indrawing. So it's that real impression that the child is working harder to breathe, or that the rate is a lot quicker. And what's actually happening there is the airways might be narrowed. So, for for example, a virus, you know, can narrow the airway like we see in asthma or bronchiolitis. So that's when you really need to access, you know, a care from an emergency department. The child may need oxygen or Ventolin depending on their age.
That is all really, really helpful advice, Professor. Thank you. I want to bring in now New South Wales AMA President, Dr. Michael Bonning, who's in the Hunter Valley. Doctor, I mean, just looking, I don't think any of us know anyone who's not sick or has a family member or a little kid at the moment who's gone through something like this. What do you put the recent surge in flu cases down to?
Good morning. Certainly, I want to start with saying, Carl, you did all the right things, you know, getting your daughter to the doctor. You know, it sounds like everyone did a great job there. And that's what GPs are doing across the state. You know, lots of GPs seeing people. What we know is that over the last 2 years, we've had far less exposure to some of these common respiratory viruses, including influenza and RSV. And so we know for infants and toddlers who may not have been exposed to RSV at all in the last 2 years, this first exposure can be quite severe. And we're seeing that as well with influenza. We know that influenza is a serious condition in children under the age of 5. They're one of our priority groups for immunisation. And that is something that we want to encourage all parents to be thinking about, especially while you know, there's a bit of a blitz on for flu vaccination at the moment across the country.
You know, the hard thing too is you can't really prescribe something to fix the cough, right? So it's all about dealing with the symptoms around the outside of it. And you're a community respiratory clinic operator. The thing that I noticed is that it went from 0 to 100 in terms of emergency really quickly. So how do you stay across that as a parent?
I mean, things with small children change quickly, and I think that's exactly it. We heard really good advice just a moment ago about what to look for in terms of how children, how their chest is moving, how they're indrawing around their ribs, around their throat. And, you know, if they're starting to become listless, if they're missing feeds, especially in young children under the age of 1, they're the reasons why we really want to make that early decision to go to hospital. I often talk to parents and between the time when we've spoken to them on the phone as part of an early triage and then the time we see them in person, things have changed.
Yeah.
And, you know, we try and make sure that, you know, and your GP is often a really good person to have that discussion with early at that time when it's a fever and a runny nose and you just want to talk to someone and get some advice. I especially say it to do it, you know, at 5 o'clock in the afternoon if the symptoms have come on across the day, because there's no one really to talk to at 2 in the morning.
Yeah.
So the idea to get some advice early and know what the triggers and warning signs are. Most states, through their children's hospitals, also have excellent fact sheets on respiratory illness that tell us exactly what the kind of warning signs are and things that we should be doing, okay. Which I think is particularly helpful for parents, especially sleep-deprived parents in the middle of the night.
Yeah.
Yeah, look, really good advice for both of you there. Thank you, because, you know, it's, as you say, there's nothing more terrifying than when one of your kids goes down and goes down quickly when they're sick. So thank you for
Brilliant.
That.